Now this is a second gen design of the cabin of what I showed you earlier, the rover I showed you. But they decided instead of putting this on a chassis, they built an air sled, replaced it on an air sled, and they started training crews a few years back on flyby an asteroid. They practiced talkback in this unit as well. So this is the one, you might have an idea, train the crew to go when you go up to the planet. This would be your home away from home. Now the airlock is originally you saw on the cabin one, it had it on the exterior, it had an awning over where the spacesuit would be kept. This one, since it will be out in orbit, they placed it, built a actual airlock. So you climb down into your suit, exit out of this airlock, and go out and over and explore the asteroid. Now, so this is the concept right now. R2 or Robonaut could actually fit on this unit. This is actually the one that you saw in the photo. This minus the Robonaut on it right now. That is Centaur 2. And behind that is the MMU, a man maneuvering unit. I'd say they might use that in the future. It was tested on a shuttle mission years ago. Bruce McCandless was the first man to fly out of the cargo bay of the shuttle Tether 3. Jerry Ross was the second man on the same mission. After that, NASA decided that they would go back to tethering the crews. But it's not that it didn't work. The design worked, but they decided just to be on the safer side, just to tether the crews when they would go out for their spacewalk. But for the future, so you do go to the asteroid, maybe you'll have one of these that you can take with you, and maybe this you could utilize that to go over and fly over to that asteroid. Don't know exactly what the plan is, but that's a concept that could happen, could bring be brought forward. Possibility being used even if you go to another planet. So maybe you can take these and shoot you from your base to wherever you're going to go, land at another site or something. But there's a possibility of that. But it is an original thing. This one hadn't flown, but it could have flown, but it has the flight tag still in place. But this is some of the future things that design the robots. Let's walk on back.
So this was originally known as Cherry. So
chariot, they decided to put a cabin on it, make it a space electric rope or a space exploration rope. Concept of a lunar rover, the second gen of the lunar rover. So this one has not virtual reality, the Robonaut's a virtual reality. This one is actually can be controlled by remote control, or it can be driven by a Robonaut, or it can be driven manually, and it has the concept is to be able to program it, send it 3 miles away. This could go 3 miles out from wherever you're exploring or excavating. And then you can meet up to where you send it off to, so it will be paused and waiting for you wherever that might be. And it has virtual eye recognition, so I guess maybe if there's some aliens on the planet or some Martians, they can't drive it. Gotta have your eyes. They tested this, so it worked with it. I'm gonna walk across the floor. We're all gonna come back this way in just a moment. So wipe your step and go across. Floor is a raised floor.
You know the name of this robot?
I think
one of our interns is working on
this. This is CCISD
robot.
Students come out
here. Oh, yeah, yeah. It's
very totally yeah, robot.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's work sick. Out here. So.
This force is pretty good.
No, this isn't the one.
Yeah, it is, because it sucks that dodgeball up and then. I don't know which one. I think this must be the arm. It shoots it into that basket.
Yeah, they just started building this in here.
6 weeks ago or something.
Yeah. More
but this one is more current. This is the layout that you see here.
I don't know if this is the newest model.
But
last year's model.
But last year, they were here. These teams won. They did really well in competition. So they laid this floor, it's been over a little over a year ago that this floor was laid for the students of this district. So this is where they come now. So now the new concept is what they're working on is with these basketballs and with the balls and the hoops. We're asking not to touch anything because I don't, I know the people around here and about, but we're going to come across and I'm going to go to the robots here. But this is where the students of CCISD come. Work on their robots for their competitions. So this is the newest layout that they've actually set up in here for them. Now if y'all come this way please, I want to talk about the robots that we have over here. These are NASA.
Damn.
Let's talk a little bit about NASA. These robonauts are actually, one is out in space, it's known as R2. And R2 lives on inside the ISS. It does have legs, and the legs were tested down here. They on this one. So his brother's out in space. So he has an older brother that lives out in space. He has younger brothers. There's a whole group of these robots that are more working on the advancement of them. And this one, they do test the legs and the movements of it as well. I'm not sure they've been doing some tweaking on it. But the concept is to be able to send this up with the crew. Or send it without a crew to some other planet, and they can go and explore a planet where you might not send a crew. Or you send them to an area where it's on a habitable planet, but you're not sure about what's on the other side. So you can send one of these robonauts out to explore. So he's dexterous, so he can operate a BlackBerry, pick up sheets of paper, operate tools, whatever they have for him to do, he can accomplish that task so far. So this was a second gen. This is NASA and General Motors. General Motors had an idea to create a robot that they wanted to put in their company. NASA was already advanced with this because they had created the original one. This is one of the original robonauts. He is known as Centaur 1. So it was an upper torso that they designed after the first that had one leg. They decided they wanted one that could be a mobile unit. So why don't we make one mobile, create Centaur 1, send it out and go out and collect samples. So they're using virtual reality. I think it has like four cameras. If you look in the T shape, you see the four or five cameras there. And those are the eyes, and that's what they're looking for. So whatever your movements are, becomes his movements. So Robonaut's going to make your movements. You being back at base with the helmet in love, he's doing the task. Bring it back in too. This guy, not sure which planets or where he would go, but these are so you have DARPA and NASA for the original, and then the second gen was NASA and General Motors. Over here,
the planet.
The one chassis that we have over here. So that gives you an idea of the design of that. But I want to take us back and we're going to walk through. I'm going to go show you an Orion and we're going to show you a Soyuz capsule as well. So I'm going to show you a real spacecraft in just a moment. Yeah. So this floor, they used to actually do this out with the students out at the NBL in one of the facilities out there. And last year, it's been about a year now, the robotics team laid this floor. So whoever is robotics, I don't see any of the guys around. I see one of the ladies over there today. I don't see any of the guys around that are with the robotics division here. And they work with the students here. So this is their office, so why not lay it, and they put this in. Within a matter of time, they had it laid, and the kids were coming here working on the robots.
That's cool.
This is what some of them do. They work on and design different types of gears and wheels and different types of things for these robots. Even different lamps are separate units that can actually be operated just by itself, maybe, or attached to one leg, maybe, on a robot. So come on over, let's go in. I want to take this over and show you the Orion. So this is the Orion home. So everything you need here, toilet, galley, is all inside this unit. You're going to climb from the inside down into the spacesuit. As you can see, they've got the handrails above it. And when you climb, when it's time to come back in, you just reach up and lift yourself out of the spacesuit back into the cabin. So, let's go this way. Now, one thing I'm going to point out is the cannon arm. There was a cannon arm in here, and all of that area that you see that's with the robotics division over there, that used to be dedicated to the floor itself, had a mock-ups and different types of size mock-ups on it, and they had some inflatables in there as well that they would use. And the cannon arm for shuttle is in a cargo bay that went across the back of the building here. So all that was shuttle, dedicated to shuttle, and the cannon arm. Thank you.
Anyone seen this?
Looks like it. That would be really cool. Who's this age? Number seven?
Oh, Bryce Harper.
I don't know who that is.
Bryce Harper said that's right.
Gives you an idea of the tool size of the toolbox. Now, these are two of our fallen heroes. This wall was put in place in 2006, so the collage was an idea of one of the NASA employees. And so they created this to remember all of them by. And the plaques are actually known as the Space Flight Memorial Wall. And that was put, those were probably starting in 2004. So by 2006, with the collage being designed and created, they just put them all together, and that's the Space Flight Memorial Wall. A friend of ours actually designed the plaque at the top. the graphic director for Star Trek shows and movies. And so he helped him put his create his design that you see there. The red wing stands for aeronautics, the NASA meatball insignia. The sigma is in math and science stands for the sum of all, for the flight controllers it stands for the sum of the team. The 17 stars dispersed through the background represent all of our fallen heroes. The simplified version of each of the mission classes is incorporated into the design. And translated as to the stars through adversity. Another translation is it's a rough road to the stars. NASA teams, they like to use Latin phrases to represent their team, and they have they'll choose a motto. And Super Explorer was another phrase they used. Ken Ham, one of the shuttle pilots, gave them that idea, always exploring. So April 12th in 2004, the original wall was hung over in the last shuttle mission control room. When we go there, if we get our opportunity to go there, I'll show you that original wall. But there's many of those walls now, and they hang all around the JSC and around the country now. So that's the Space Flight Memorial Walk.
Walk on the Moon and Walk on Mars. The Canary Bearing Rail, Charles Finger Bear, the rod that you see here attached, hooked on the side here. Once it's loose and the air is going on across that rod, it bounces and it oscillates across that. It creates like a, if you're attached to this, you're on the bouncing end of a pogo stick. And they, when they have the astronaut in the spacesuit, it's attached to something that looks like a hand gliding rail. A portion of that is attached off of this as well. They'll have a horse rehabilitation treadmill, a huge treadmill set up. And you have to learn to walk from, get from the ground to that treadmill and walk in 1/3 gravity of Mars or 1/6 gravity of the moon, whatever they create. And so you can practice walking on the moon or Mars here. You practice your EVA spacewalk here. That's the test station where you will practice translating, moving from handrail to handrail or using different types of tools, tightening and loosening the nuts and bolts. So a lot of different things that they can do with it. You're testing out the equipment that they need here as well. But this is how the Apollo crew learned to walk on the moon. That's what this unit. But it was actually on the back of a flatbed trailer. So it was actually driving around campus and they were practicing the moonwalk on the around the campus. Down in the building, somebody got an idea? The building is how it's coming to. See the orange material coming out of the box that breaks off of the floor? That orange and blue material, that is an actual solar array. It's the only one that's left here on Earth. It's 120 feet tall that you see that. That is, the box itself is called the solar blanket. So it folds in and out of the solar blanket. You see those blue cells or units on it? Those are the fuel cells. That's what's holding the power to create the power for the ISS. This is extended out 127 feet. They have to bring the hole in the ceiling, extended another 57 feet to fully build out the 120 feet total. The cells are made of silicone. The orange material is mylar, so mylar and silicone is what's powering the ISS. There's four sets of these that are out in space. Let's log down into the Soyuz. The Soyuz, as I mentioned, this was a real spacecraft and it was built to go into space, but it failed to test, so here it is. About maybe 3-4 years ago. It's been very
It's pretty new with the new design interior. But overall, everything you see in there, all the different bags and things you see, is survival gear, and I'll have even more survival gear in there once they actually, right before the mission launch, they'll put more things in. Because they land somewhere back around the territory of Pakistan, and that could be anywhere. Because there have been times when the wind, a gust of wind, has caught the parachute, and it sent them sailing off course, and on one mission was 250 miles, I think, off course. So it might take a little time to find you. And it's uncharted territory, pretty much, you might say. So there's a lot of terrain out there that that's not happening. A lot of wild animals live in the area. So they have to figure out where you are and find your location. This is a soybean. They are too large, as you can see. The pool would need to be bigger to put them in flight configuration if they were in that pool. Learn all about the workings of all the working equipment. Everything you need to know, you're going to learn here. Now, come right this way. Inside the Dragon. So this is here for the teams and crews to get to understand and learn how to put things into the Dragon and how far they're located to take them out. So, excuse me, she's going to pass this here. I'll just set aside for now. Okay. All right. Level up!